You want answers?
I'm as mad as hell, and I'm not going to take this anymore.
You want answers?
You have offended my family.
I think I'm entitled.
You want answers?
I want the truth.
And you have offended a Shaolin temple.
You can't handle the truth.
Surely you can't be serious.
I am serious, and don't call me Shirley. Hoo-ah!
Radical rant.
You know, I got thinking recently about this whole scare about big tobacco and big marijuana. Most of this comes from Kevin Sabet. You know, I follow him daily. I hope to be his nemesis. I hope that I just hope this is all working, is what I'm saying. But anyway, I was following this Kevin Sabet stuff and checking out his Project Sam website. And this is a scaremongering that we hear a lot, not just from the opposite side, not from the Patrick Kennedys and the Kevin Sabets, but we also hear it on our side from some of the more sincere and devoted legalizers. And that's this idea of when marijuana gets legalized, big tobacco is going to step in and it's going to be big marijuana. It's going to lie to the kids. It's going to bring out Joe Camel. It's going to lie about how harmful everything is. It's going to get everyone addicted. It's going to be a terrible, terrible thing, just like big tobacco was. And this gets repeated a lot. And I want to cover it from both sides. Let's start with the Kevin Sabet side. He's got a page up there on the Project Sam website that is dedicated to the whole fear mongering about big tobacco. And this is one of his quotes. He says, "We know if it's legalized, marijuana will be commercialized too. A commercial marijuana industry will act just as the tobacco industry acts. Big tobacco may even take over a marijuana industry once it's up and running." Now, never mind the fact that we already do have a big marijuana, and that big marijuana is the Mexican cartels that are beheading people and doing some terrible things and killing 10,000 people a year. We already have big marijuana. And never mind the fact that if a big marijuana existed like big tobacco, it would have to create jobs, pay taxes, and so forth, you know, be inspected and all that. Never mind all that. The fear here is big tobacco would take over the marijuana industry once it's up and running. And in the page, he points out that Altria, which is the parent company of Philip Morris, recently bought the web domain names AltriaCannabis.com and AltriaMarijuana.com. So this is part of the scare, right? Big tobacco is already waiting for marijuana to be legalized, and they're snapping up the web domain names so that as soon as it's legalized, they can capitalize on it, right? That's the idea. The problem is, if you do a little clicking, if you do a little looking through the internet, on the link that Kevin Sabet provides himself, you can find some interesting information. When he has that sentence, "It recently bought the web domains Altria Cannabis and Altria Marijuana," it links back to a story from 2009 on a website called Domain Name Wire. And Domain Name Wire, supposedly the news source for the internet domain name industry. What, you didn't know there was an internet domain name industry? Yeah, there is. People buy and sell and trade domain names. So, you know, marijuana.com went for $4.2 million. There is a whole industry around these internet domain names. So anyway, this Domain Name Wire published, what they had to say on this was that Altria was not just buying the domain names AltriaCannabis.com and AltriaMarijuana.com off the open market, like no one had been using them. The fact was, an unknown person in Washington, D.C. had purchased AltriaCannabis.com and AltriaMarijuana.com. And in 2009, Altria went to federal court in an arbitration proceeding to get the domain names that had their brand in it from this unknown person in Washington, D.C. who had already registered them. It just so happens to be a coincidence that in 2009, Kevin Sabet was living in Washington, D.C. as an advisor to the drug czar. The person who registered Altria Marijuana and Altria Cannabis, it's an anonymous listing through an IT host. So we can't know for sure who registered those pages. But basically what this was Altria trying to get domain names that had their brand in it away from someone who was misusing them. And in fact, if you go to the websites now, altriamarijuana.com and altriacannabis.com, what you will find is a blank white page. There's nothing up there. So it's not as if Altria bought them and is doing anything with them at the point at this time. Now, what used to be on those pages? Well, I took a look. And I got a snapshot from archive.org, which, you know, archive.org takes snapshots of websites. And I wasn't able to get a snapshot from 2009, but I did get one from January of 2010, which apparently was, it was able to cache this picture of what the page looked like before Altria took it down. Here is what the page read before the tobacco company got to it. Thank you for visiting our site to fight the legalization of marijuana. Our goal is to inform you about the new cases like California Prop 215 and California Senate Bill 420. These cases have made legal marijuana cannabis for so-called medical use, decriminalizing this dangerous narcotic and allowing less than upstanding members of society to become state-sanctioned drug dealers who profit from the misery of others. Other states have since followed suit, and a virtual domino effect has thus transpired. As such, nearly 30% of our states have decriminalized marijuana cannabis in one way or another. Now, a new and greater threat is on the horizon as California Assembly Bill 390 proposed to completely legalize the sale and use of marijuana cannabis. We fear that this will likely cause a similar, although far more massive, domino effect, as was the case with decriminalization. Furthermore, even righteous states that oppose the legalization of drugs and continue to fight the good fight have to have unlimited access to or stand to be severely impacted by passing of California Assembly Bill 390, as drug dealers will have unlimited access to marijuana cannabis simply by traveling to California and other states that follow suit and decide legalize marijuana cannabis. No, I didn't read that wrong. The end of it says, and decide legalize marijuana cannabis. Greater than the sum of all these fears is the premonition that, when made legal, big business, especially those big businesses that profit from poisoning our society and destroying our youth with tobacco and alcohol, will engage in and ultimately control this multi-billion dollar industry, furthering the decline and destruction of America at an unfathomable rate. Thus, it is the mission of this website to fight the legalization and usage of marijuana, cannabis, and all other intoxicating, addicting, and illicit substances. That doesn't sound like anything Kevin Sabet would write, does it? So here we have a website, altriamarijuana.com, altriacannabis.com, dedicated to fighting against the legalization of marijuana, painting this demonization picture of big tobacco coming in and taking it over. And only then did Altria go and get those websites back, because maybe perhaps they didn't want to be seen as being demonizing something that was incredibly popular. But let's take a look at the other side of this, and that would be this our side, which, you know, we look back to Prop 215 and that Prop 19 in California, and the voters in the Emerald Triangle voted against it. They defeated it in Mendocino by 6%. They defeated it in Humboldt by 8%. And the person that I turned to on this one is Doug Fine. He's the author of Too High to Fail. He's also been a guest on this show. And he spent a couple of years embedded with the farmers in the Emerald Triangle to ask what they thought legal marijuana would be like. And this one 31-year-old cannabis farmer he's calling Mark says, quote, "It'll be the end of the small farmer. Folks will be buying packages of joints made by Coors or Marlboro." And that's the fear among some of the people on our side, is that once it becomes legal, then there's going to be a huge problem trying to get into the business. Doug Fine writes it like this. "I've found that the answer has as much to do with simple accounting as the more common outsider assumption that farmers fear the price drops that come when a prohibitionary economy dissolves. When, in three generations of farming, your family has never had to pay taxes, record payroll, or meet building code, let alone meet a customer, the prospect of coming above ground and dealing with the same red tape every other industry does can be terrifying. So some of these farmers, like all successful small business owners in any industry, resist change in a knee-jerk fashion by distributing worst-case scenarios the way some people pass around business cards. Look at tobacco," Mark said. "They've made the paperwork crazy complicated so only giant corporate farmers can afford to grow it commercially." And he's actually correct. Section 40 of Title 27 of the Alcohol and Tobacco Tax and Trade Bureau's regulations has 534 subsections. You need a corporate lawyer on call to endure this document without a migraine. The system favors big producers, and big tobacco is at least paying attention to federal drug law. NPR reports that Philip Morris trademarked the brand Marley in 1983. And Dan Mitchell reported in Fortune that Brown and Williamson enthusiastically advised in a 1970s internal report that the company start viewing marijuana as an alternative product line. But what's really happening is the more sensible growers in the Emerald Triangle have formed something called the Emerald Growers Association, and they are looking for the craft brew model. And this is something I've been pointing out for a long time. Folks, don't be afraid of the Budweiserification or the Marlboro-ification of marijuana, whatever you want to call it, the corporatization, the Walmart weed. Don't be afraid of that. They're gonna put out, you know, packs of cheap ass mid-grade joints for people. Great. Let the people who want to smoke cheap mid-grade joints have them. That'll be fine with me. But I'm not going to be smoking them. I'm going to be smoking the good Pacific Northwest bud I've always been able to get, and that's what the EGA, Emerald Growers Association, is saying in this as well. He points out that American craft beer was an $8 billion market in the U.S. last year. Thomas Balog of the EGA board says, we're not afraid of what might be stocked next to cheap beer and cigarettes at the corner store. He points out that we're talking about a $35 billion a year cash crop here in the United States, which is greater than the value of corn and wheat combined. But even, and he says, this is the board member from EGA again, says, quote, even if your worst fears about modern corporate ethics are correct, there is still a niche for top shelf organically grown cannabis like the Emerald Triangle provides, end quote. But here's where the difference is. If you're just a guy who's been, you know, pumping out buds using pesticides and shady techniques or whatever, and you expect to be able to keep doing that in the post-legalization future, that's where you're going out of business. This reminds me, harkens back for me to the early days in when I was playing music professionally, when karaoke came out. A lot of musicians were really upset about karaoke coming out. Oh my God, all these bars are getting rid of their live music gigs. They're putting in karaoke. This sucks. It's going to kill musicians. No, it doesn't. Kills the bad musicians. The good musicians, the good bands can always draw better than a karaoke machine. But the mid-grade, middle-of-the-road musicians who are just serving as sonic wallpaper, hell, we can get a machine and some drunks for that. That's what's going to happen with marijuana. If you've just been getting by because it's prohibited and you're the guy in your town and you've been able to supply buds of got some, hey, what kind of strain you got? I got some. You want some? If you've been that guy, yeah, it's going to be tough for you in the legalized world when you're going to have to compete against large scale growers and industrial farming techniques. But the other part that's interesting about this, in reading Doug Fine's article, he talks about how a lot of these growers would, these small growers would benefit a lot from legalization, because not only can they sell their buds, but now they can do anything they want to do with all those leftover stocks that aren't really being used for much of anything. Now, those could be converted for, you know, biofuels, building materials, all sorts of things. And the tourism involved. They are pointing out, this is again, that EGA people are saying that Mendocino and Humboldt counties are going to do for cannabis what Napa Valley did for wine. Napa Valley just did $11 billion in tourism business, not buying wines when you get there, just people touring the wineries. So get ready for cannabis tincture massages and tasting tours farm tours. It's just going to be an amazing thing. But we can control this and we can be a part of this. Don't fear the change that's coming up. Steer the change that's coming up. Be a part of this. Go to those city council meetings. Go to those state board hearings and become a part of making the rules the way we want them. Make it so that we can still have a niche market of small garden farmers. Hey, we're going to take a little break, and when we come back, we're going to have Georgia Mom for Marijuana, Sharon Ravert, on the line, telling us all about the latest saga of the Cannabis Quilt. You're listening to the Russ Bellville Show. See you in a minute.